Hey, Harini, thank you so much for your time. So I'm going to quickly jump into the conversation because, you know, the aim of this conversation is really to get a win-win solution for both the audience as well as the brand. Because clearly there is some sort of connect. It's just a little, you know, going through a little bit of rough waters. So with that, you know, I want to introduce you with a very short introduction, though you don't need one because, you know, yours is a brand. We started from a kiosk. A lot of people have traveled with you, and it's now that there's been a little bit of backlash in terms of the quality, the quantity, and the customer care. But, you know, the understanding is that, you know, for a brand to grow, there's going to be pain in the growth. So I wanted you to share your side of where is the brand today? What are you going through? Because clearly the audience is feeling the pains and is only able to see the pain, not able to see, you know, the work and the, you know, the effort that's going into create what they are participating in.
Right. So absolutely. So I'm Harini. Little bit background, a small background about me, how I started this quickly in 2 minutes so that we don't waste time on that. I'm basically, you know, I studied to be a banker, but I never really pursued my banking career very seriously for various personal reasons. And then fast forward, I think in 2015 was the time I literally was experimenting a lot with, you know, skincare. And at that point of time back in India, it was really tough to find, you know, skincare that did not have fragrance. Literally, you know, at least I wasn't a net savvy person back in 2015, where I used to sit on internet and figure out, you know, I wasn't even on Instagram back then. So I just started off making, you know, very, very simple skincare back in 2015. I started making soaps, whipped body butters, and literally, I never even dreamt in my life I'll be an entrepreneur someday. Even now, I most of the times, even my dad tells me that, Harini, you always think like an employee. You don't think like an owner. I just don't feel that way because, you know, sometimes you could also blame it to be the brought up that you've always trained, you know, you do an MBA, fancy MBAs, and then, you know, have that 7-digit salary and then do the 9-to-6 kind of a role. So that's how, you know, I was brought up in an environment, you know, the way that I came up. So when I started in 2015, literally the idea was never to make it into a business or anything. It just gave me a lot of joy to create products. And I used to share these typically with my friends, family. And that was the time I had relocated to Delhi. And it was really fun for me to, you know, probably get a lot of compliments at that point of time because a lot of people around me were enjoying these products. These are very simple products, just, you know, whipped shea butter, a simple cold process soap or something like that. In 2016, I spent a lot of time. I think 2016, I did a course from Formula Botanica. 2017, I did a course from Institute of Personal Care Science. So this was a stage where, you know, the passion became a bit more serious for me and I wanted to study. Even at that point of time while studying, I really didn't think that someday I'm going to start a brand, I'm going to make it into a business or anything of that sort. But it was really exciting to learn chemistry and all of that, how, you know, things were made. And literally until 2017, if you've seen my LinkedIn post, actually I had put a picture of, you know, how the evolution happened, that single room inside my house where I sat and I really, you know, was working on so many things, trying out different products, you know, literally, you know, going through every single website, every single, you know, ingredient list that was there out there. And that's how it started. And in 2018 was the time, you know, a lot of people were coming back to Earth Rhythm. At that time, it was called Soapworks India. They were coming back to us and buying time and again for this one simple reason that, you know, they felt that they could get some customized skincare from smaller brands. They could ask the smaller brands to probably give them a product in a particular way. It could be packaging related, it could be product related, but they felt that they could ask, which was not available with bigger brands. So my little venture, it could no longer survive as a hobby at that point of time because I had invested a lot in terms of my education, in terms of many things. So I started, you know, I created a small GoDaddy store. I registered under MSME and, you know, I was operating as a, you know, homegrown entrepreneur. And under, you know, when you are a homegrown entrepreneur, you are limited to selling only certain types of products. That's when, you know, I realized that, I should get out of this home-based setup, because it was, you know, limiting me to a point where I could not really make quality skincare, because there are certain guidelines that you need to follow when you are an MSME, registered brand. You cannot really sell actives. You cannot sell many other things. Probably you can simply sell anhydrous products, which did not typically, like, for example, you can sell Uptan. You can sell, you know, a mask made of haldi, but you can't sell ascorbic acid or niacinamide being a brand as an MSME, right? So that pushed me to come out of my home-based setup at that point of time. And in 2019 was the time we came out of this setup and we rebranded the whole thing as Earthrhythm. The only reason why we rebranded from Soapworks to Earthrhythm was because a lot of consumers were getting confused. When we sell a moisturizer, they used to confuse with the word soap. And they used to come back and ask us, is this a soap? So we used to tell them, no, Soapworks is just the brand name. So we thought it made sense to rebrand it to Earthrhythm, where, you know, people could, you know, conveniently connect with the brand. And it started in 2019. You know, we are a completely bootstrapped company in all sense till today. Even the latest news that went out, I think one month ago about funding alert, even that was not a real news, actually, to be very honest. So the funding is yet to happen. It's not even there yet. Till today, we are completely bootstrapped. And these are certain things, you know, which are, you know, I really felt in this entire journey that there's a lot of disconnect between the brand and the consumers. Being a bootstrap for us, essentially, I have the ability to invest the little money that we have in, you know, which we earn from this business into either product formulation, all of these part of the business, or I push it into, you know, the marketing, the customer service, or building my team, getting more quality manpower on board, all of that. So I have to choose between these two. And we being a manufacturing company, like most of the brands out there, typically go into the route of third-party manufacturing, where there is a company involved who manufactures and they simply label it and put it. Now, this is because when you want to start a manufacturing unit, as against simply starting a brand in India, there are various guidelines. You need to have a Factories Act in place. You need to abide by the labor laws. You need to have fire license. You need to have safety, you know, a lot of guidelines, you know, in terms of, you know, manufacturing skincare in India. That's a completely different ballgame than that of starting a brand. So these are two separate things. Absolutely. And when a brand decides to do both together, you know, especially as a bootstrap brand, I can either do justice to this or to that. It's very difficult to do both, right? Now, if you look at the small team that we have, we are about, you know, the entire team put together, including my production guys, my packing assistants, everybody put together, we are 40 of us. The core team is just the 10 of us. Now, out of these 10 people, I put more money into having two cosmetic chemists, one biotechnology person. The reason, you know, I felt product was more important, investing on people in terms of formulation, in terms of getting more quality people on that side, product side was more important. While I felt that this could be easier to handle, you know, with one or two people on customer service. Now, the disbalance for us happened, really, I think we grew out of proportion suddenly, which is a good and a bad thing in a way.
Right.
The good thing is, you know, people are willing to buy your product and try it and see. That's a very good thing. But the bad thing is we do not have the bandwidth to really, you know, capitalize on this. So so many people, they came back to us and asked us that, you know, why you don't have a phone number? We can't contact you. Now, we have only one person handling emails, just one lady. And as of today, there are about 200 mails coming in through that channel. And then there is DMs. And then there is Facebook chat. And then there are two other chat channels. And one mail, she needs at least 20 minutes to evaluate and come back to that customer on a mail, what happened, why the package is delayed, where is it stuck, or if there is a damage, she has to again investigate how the damage happened, what happened to the product. So each mail takes her so much time. And we are getting there. The problem is, I think, we're stuck between the space of, you know, being bootstrapped and trying to grow. That's really been very difficult for us. And that's the honest scenario, to be very honest.
I think exactly what you're saying is what the customer is reflecting, right? Because you have chosen the harder path. There are two pathways to grow a skincare brand today. One is aap product conceptualize karo and give it to the manufacturing unit. They will do everything. You are just a branding and a selling team. That's all you do, you know. You don't do anything beyond
that. We chose that path also very carefully, Rubina, because when you third-party manufacture, right? Like, this was a very, very serious discussion we had in 2019 when we wanted to come out also. Yeah. Whether, in fact, you know, while we were even discussing with many investors, they were very skeptical about investing in a brand that had a manufacturing unit themselves. Believe me, even investors are really finding it tricky to invest in brands like us.
Yeah.
Because having a manufacturing unit and a factory is completely a big role to do than running a brand.
Absolutely.
So it's like, you know,
parts of the business.
Exactly.
Two different operation, branding, marketing, sales is a different operation. And that's why most of the skincare new brands that have come, all of them have third party manufacturing. You manufacture the product for us, we are going to do the marketing, sales, customer care. So their pay is limited to that, you know. But you've chosen the harder path. You are like, you know, we are going to do marketing, sales, and, you know, the formulation of the product. We're also going to manufacture the product. So clearly, this is the harder path, right? And so all the pains, the growth pains that you're experiencing is what the audience is coming back to you at with, right? So if you quickly discuss the issues that, you know, we saw, there is this, I have all of them recorded. So the first question is that every time when they repurchase, why is there a difference in the product, you know? Hmm. So then when we try to link the fact that you're controlling manufacturing also, this issue technically shouldn't come. So why is this issue coming?
So I'll tell you why this happens. So most of the times now, let's take the recent issue, which was the LS-COBIC, you know, how you reached out to me for that issue, right? So let's take the very latest issue that came up. Now, initially when we formulated that product, we used a couple of ingredients. While manufacturing the batch itself, it had a golden tint or an amberish tint to it in the initial stages, in the first stage of production itself. But when we rolled out that, and we could not control it at that point of time because there was a penetrator in the formulation, which we felt, which at least my team felt was very, very effective. But of course, it did alter the, you know, the color of the entire product in itself. So we had to take a call saying that, okay, let's be more towards efficacy and not bother, because we had, you know, spent a lot of money on clinical trials for this formulation and various other things. So we thought that, you know, let's keep it like this and we will launch it. But then when consumers come back, now we have a threshold, right? When a product has a problem, at least 5%, we have kept a threshold of 5%. Every company keeps their own threshold. It can be 5, it can be 3, it can be 2, it can be even 1. Now we keep it as 5. And when 5% of the consumers who have bought this in the last 6 months comes back to us saying that, you know, there is a complaint, or they come back with a feedback, we go back to the drawing board and to see if this can be, you know, bettered or not. Now that's the kind of, you know, way that we have, you know, taken in internally, you know, the protocols to, you know, follow. And in this case, a lot of time consumers came back to us, and, you know, especially on Instagram, I constantly had feedback from my team saying that, you know, they all felt that, how do we know that if it's oxidizing or not, while if the product itself is, you know, in amber color, like, you know, the first stage of, you know, ascorbic acid going oxidized is becoming orange or amber, then how do we know if your product is like this?
Right.
So we felt it's a valid point. And I went back and I told my team, if we can work around this and if we can make the color to something more, you know, whitish or transparent, or however we can make it, where consumers will find it more easier to do it. While we take feedback and we do this, again, the problem comes back that we effectively are not able to put this back to the consumers, telling them, hey, there is a communication gap, which, you know, recently after speaking to you, you know, we took the call, you know, yesterday also we put a story post saying that, you know, we've made a change in our recent formulation. Now you will find that the concentrate will be translucent and it will not be in amber color. So many people who have previously purchased, or any influencer or a blogger who would have posted an application video which had a different color would be really, you know, the viewers will be alarmed by it. And that's how, you know, all these confusions crop up. But we are trying to address it. But I think majorly this happens because, you know, even let's take the cleansing balm, right? Now, during the relaunch in February, we brought in a new formulation. And we launched that formulation only because prior to that, until January, the one that we were selling, we had feedback from many customers that it caused a lot of people for eye irritation. They could not use it to remove their eye makeup. So I myself use almost all of my products and I didn't have that issue, but there is a segment of people who have sensitive eyes, yeah, and who are getting, it irritates their eye. So we thought while doing the relaunch, why not change the formulation of the cleansing balm? And when we changed the formulation, believe me, the fans of the old formulation, they came back lashing, saying that, you know, hey, no, why did you change the formulation? I want the old formulation back. Now, again, it all boils down to the bandwidth that we have. We cannot make everybody happy, right? Now, there are some people who likes a certain type of formulation, some people don't like certain type of formulation. Some people like foaming cleansers. Some people does not even like foam in their cleansers. So it's very difficult to satisfy everybody. So when we launched, at least 40% of the people came back to us with a feedback that please bring back your old formulation. It's not 1-2. And we took that call again because we only believed that what we are here only to make the consumers happy. And if they're not happy with the change that we have made, I don't think it's even, you know, it's pointless to even put that product on the shelf to sell it in the market when consumers have really seen a better product. You know, they really like the previous one. So we tried to better it again. We tried to say change certain ingredients and ensured that eye irritation was under control. And we relaunched the old one again. So what happened was in February, March, the balm was softer in February. And in March, in April, we took the call to again make it a little harder because consumers, you know, by this time in February and, you know, March, we had tons of consumers coming back saying that please get back. There were some consumers who were willing to even buy old stock. Can you believe me? They used to write mails to us saying that if you have any stock from the previous lot before the launch, I don't mind buying that. So that really made us feel bad. That consumers are really wanting this product, which was already there on the shelf. And how do we, you know, and we, like I told you, there's a protocol. We just don't take call like overnight essay. We don't do it. We try to send out mailers. Now we're slowly putting things into place. We're trying to do survey whenever there is a change that we are forecasting. We're trying to work on, you know, tools like this Klaviyo and everything. And we're sending out an emailer to customers for them to simply put, you know, select an option about that product as to did they like the texture? What is that one thing that did not like about the product? That gives us more idea as to whether to change that formulation. But these are, you know, work in progress still. These are not completely implemented. And for us to get there, it takes time.
Yeah. So I think clearly there are two aspects what I see to it. One thing is that here is a brand which is trying to do its best by the customer. But of course, you're also a brand which is learning. You've never done this before, right? And in your effort to do best by the customer, there are some things that you don't kind of foresee initially, like, you know, a communication going to the customer that, hey, the second generation of this product may not be what you had the first time. Expect changes. And so obviously this is, you're going to get wiser when you do the next generation of changes. So that's one aspect that's going to be sorted. But on the customer's end, what they are seeing is, ki, are mera product change ho gaya. You know, which becomes very discomforting for them. But now that the customers know that why it has happened, I think a lot of them will kind of understand where you are coming from.
Also one small point I want to make. Most of the times, inconsistency comes when batch sizes are very small, right? Now if you look at huge factories, look at L'Oreal, I'm just taking a random example, they wouldn't be manufacturing 5 kgs and 10 kgs of a product, right? They would be manufacturing in say 500 kgs, 1000 kgs of a product. Now when such a big batches made, consistencies are generally maintained. And when, you know, now we are at a threshold of manufacturing 100 kgs at one go, right? That is our threshold right now. That's where we are at the moment. So when we manufacture like 100 kgs batch, there is a possibility in the second batch, if there is a small tweak also, the next batch has a slight variation. It could be the texture, it could be the color, or it could be anything. Like I said, the only mistake I think we are doing right now is the communication about these changes are much slower. And I think that's something that we're definitely working on.
Yeah, it's definitely worth addressing, because I think as long as the consumer knows or is prepared for a change or a surprise, then the reaction is different. Because the thing what catches them is, oh, I'm surprised. Because, you know, also the Indian consumer is also at the brunt of facing a lot of scammy brands. So everybody is like, am I being cheated? You know, that is the biggest thing. But as long as that fear is being addressed upfront, ki no, bhaiya, it's the same thing. Itna change expect karo, this change is not going to be there. I think their fears are addressed upfront. So that might give them a better experience with every product change. So you kind of addressed the first two questions with the glow boost and everything. The third question was that, you know, you have massive sale across your stores. So generally it's buy one and get two free. So the general suggestion from everybody was that instead of doing that, why don't you just lower the MRP? Because the perception is that products do cost, you know, they're a little more expensive than they would like it to be. So instead of having a sale, why not just revise the MRP? But that's a, you know, that's a call that you need to take, because you've got so many other costs to look at, right? It's not just the product costs, and manufacturing, people costs, shipping costs, everything. So, I mean, what
okay, my thoughts on that, I will tell you my, I don't know how much sense this will make, but I'm just going into how, you know, some nitty-gritties of running a business about fundraising and various other things, right? So there are certain metrics that we as brands need to maintain. There's something called average order value that we need to maintain. Something like, you know, the repeat rates, cohorts that we need to maintain for a brand. How many times a consumer is coming back to the brand to buy a product? How many times, you know, what is the average ticket size that a consumer is willing to spend at Earth through them? There are so many metrics that goes into planning a month's digital schedule for us. And that's how we plan it, to be very honest. Now, from a customer's perspective, yes, we really wish that we could reduce. But, you know, for us, I take so much pride, Rubina, in telling that, you know, although we are not heard on this front many times out there, I still will tell it time and again that we have taken so much pain to ensure that our factory is GMP certified. Every year there are EcoCert audits conducted in our factory. Still, there is a, you know, a notion that, you know, Indian brand, kitchen brand, obviously it should be made like, you know, we are working towards it. Like, you know, we're planning to make more informative posts where we're trying to take a video of the factory setup, how certain products are made. If you've seen the Lush website, how certain things are made. We're trying to work on such videos so consumers get to see the machineries we use, the kind of ingredients that go into the product, the kind of, you know, effort that the team takes in terms of cleanliness, in terms of, you know, how products are manufactured. Like, we take pride that, you know, every single product that is manufactured, right from raw materials to finished goods, there is no human touch in the product at all. We've ensured that that kind of a mechanism where raw materials are filled into drums, there is an oil tank, there is a wax tank. It, you know, it, everything is automated. It goes into the manufacturing vessels. From there is a pipe that runs towards the filling unit, and then everything is automated. So we have taken that effort to ensure that there is cleanliness, there is quality, there is, you know, certifications in place, all of that. But somehow, I think for us, you know, in terms of digital marketing, you know, like I told you, again, going back to the fact that we are bootstrapped, I think while you had shared that link with me, I also saw about influencer marketing. Why is Earth Rhythm actually doing a lot of influencer marketing and all that? Now, there are two types of influencer marketing that you will see that happens in the, you know, in the environment there. One is, there are agencies, that is big brands who have the luxury to spend a lot of money. They go to big brands. You will see agencies approaching all the micro nano influencers or even the high-end influencers, and then approaching them to create content and give. Now, we do not have the bandwidth for that. You would have never seen in the past, like if you ask any influencer, you know, you would never hear from them that an agency contacted on behalf of them, because we do not have the bandwidth for that at all. We don't have a PR agency in place. We don't have anybody in place. So how we have dealt with is that we have an email ID that we have kept dedicated for collaboration requests. And I have told my team that since we don't have the bandwidth to really, you know, pump money into influencer marketing, please, you know, if you think that the influencer is really, you know, creating great content, we should, you know, appreciate them, please, you know. And, you know, we take pride in telling that we never ask any influencer to put a certain type of content. Please put positive review, negative review, put whatever. Even if they don't post a review, we don't even call up, you know, we don't even mail them and ask, hey, why didn't you put a review? We leave it to their, you know, will. If you want to post, you post. If you really like the product, you will post about it somewhere in your journey. So we've left it like that. And these are certain things that, these are certain decisions, I think, that, you know, if the company has to run, these metrics have to be followed. These are some things that are, you know, not compromisable. If I, you know, there are certain brands who probably will take a stand. I know there are certain brands in the market which keeps the prices under control, but do not believe in doing any kind of, you know, sale or anything of that sort. It works for them. But I think every brand has a certain strategy that works on, right? And this strategy is built on certain planning that is there for the entire year that we have. So I think that's how, you know, we have segmented the whole digital plan.
Yeah, so I think, I mean, in today's market, it's very easy to have the right marketing and the advertising to sell the worst product, and the best product can get lost because it's not rightly packaged, marketed, and spoken about. You know, so we are living in that world, and that's the truth of it, right? So the last question was that a lot of the consumers, audience and the community feel that a lot of the negative, you know, feedback that goes back to the brand is managed. Now, my understanding, I come from a business side, you know, I've been in startup, I've been in startup world and all that. I know that for sure that brands have to manage a lot of the sentiment online, you know, and it's politically not correct for me to take brands' names, but I know it's done. I can see it. But I would like for you to answer this question as a business owner, that, you know, what is your view on it?
Okay, so when it comes to, you know, the B2C, our own website that we run, there are different places where, you know, a brand will sell. There are marketplaces, there is our own D2C website. So when it comes to marketplaces, like say a Nykaa or an Amazon, obviously we don't have control as to, you know, anything. We don't even know who this customer is. Now, when consumers write anything there, like, for example, let's take a case of Amazon. Like, we as a brand don't even have access to this customer data. We don't know who this customer is. We are just, right, you know, given data to, they don't share anything, right? There is no customer data shared. So whatever they say, we only are allowed to read. And we have, even if we want to reach out to somebody who has a problem on Amazon reviews, who's written anything, there's no way, there's no system. In fact, that was a feedback that I had even shared with, you know, in one of the meetings with Amazon, that they should have a system where we should be able to reach out to those customers, because it's completely... They don't allow. Now, in a D2C website for us, there is a mechanism. Now, we have access to these customers. Now, we try our level best. Now, if these are neutral, negative feedback. Now, there are policies. That is why, you know, every company puts a policy in place for everything. Now, if there is a negative review where a customer has clearly shared, saying that I used this is my hair type and it did not suit me, this is what happened, we definitely don't delete it. But if, you know, if there is a customer who says, if they're using any foul language, or if they've simply said horrible product without any details about the product, it could be misleading to the consumer who's coming next without any reasons to it. Now, these are rules that not every single organizations need to follow. But what we do in such situations is, we make a list, we pull them out, and we try as much as possible to revert to them. There is a way to revert privately to them where the response will go to their email ID. So these are things that we have implemented internally, that these reviews are taken as feedback and they are responded definitely. And those reviews which are clearly given to the consumers saying that, you know, I used this product for a good 4 weeks, I had this problem, I did not like it, you are, you know, that is, you know, definitely not acceptable for the brand to, you know, take it off, because I think the consumers have the right to know what the consumer actually felt. So there are some times when consumers, out of, you know, anger or, you know, hate, they just, you know, blurt out one or two even foul language in the review. We can't approve those reviews. We don't want to have those reviews on the page, because it, you know, everything, again, going back to digital, it's all SEO monitored, you know, everything is, we need to ensure that the content that is there on the website are, you know, completely, you know, able to be tracked digitally everywhere. So these are certain things why we have these policies in place. But with regards to Amazon, Nykaa, anywhere you go, I don't think we have any access also to even, you know, manipulate the reviews.
So you're saying even if someone were to send you direct feedback to your website, it is better for them to have a constructive feedback instead of just, you know, blurting out whatever they want.
Absolutely.
Cool. I think we have all of those addressed. So, you know, you are definitely, I love Earth Rhythm and I've not had reason to hate any of the products. I did have a bad experience about 3.5 years back, so I didn't buy anything. But this year when I found your website, I did find great products, like something like coffee oil, which I make on my own, to have it available from your site and use it myself is brilliant. And I've had absolutely no reason to complain. But of course, different people have different experiences. So one suggestion was also the fact that, you know, yes, you are, you know, at the forefront of innovation and you're launching a whole lot of products. Instead of that, why not just launch limited products, get them right, you know, go through 2-3 evolutions, fix them, and then go to the next level. You know?
I want to take this question. Now, this is something that repeatedly comes, right? So I'm excited to answer that. Now, I consider Earth Rhythm, although it's a brand, I told you, right? So I'm a product person. I'm obsessed with product. And I completely, you know, for us, the entire, you won't believe 2022 NPD, which is new product development list, is already ready with me. So what we do is, you know, for us, product is very, very close to us. And we keep a healthy balance, which most of the times the other side, the consumers don't see. How we address it is, if we are bringing one product into the catalog, there is definitely one product that is kicked out of the catalog, right? So recently, if you see, we've removed solid perfumes completely from the catalog altogether because there were a lot of, you know, we felt that the consumers quite didn't understand the concept. We felt that, you know, probably this is not the kind of product that the Indian consumers are most excited about. So we felt that, you know, consumers may not really be happy to spend that money on a product like solid perfume. So we knocked it off our catalog. So now that gives us space to bring not exactly 6 other products immediately on board, but throughout the year for the NPDs, we have 6 other products that could be spaced out, right? So there is a healthy balance is what I'm trying to say. Like, it may look every other month when a product is coming into the catalog. We don't really announce which product went absolute, but it is always that, you know, when two things are coming, there's always two things that's going out also. Mm-hmm. So at any point of time, now we have a threshold of 120. At any point of time, you will not see that we are having more than 120 products on catalog. Now these 120 products also includes the wooden comb, everything, all the accessories that are there on the website. So that's a number that we maintain, and there is a balance. So while what I'm trying to say is, while from the outside, it might look, hey, this month another one, there's also one knocking off. Now these knocking off happens through, you know, several analytics that we read on the website, where we pull out the reports and we see, you know, which product was the least ordered in the last 6 months. We try to study, you know, were there any complaints for that least ordered product? Probably, you know, people, you know, came back with certain complaints for that product. So that product generally does not go absolute. It goes back to the, you know, reformulation stage, where our chemists sit back and they figure out, you know, can this be better? Can, you know, should we really kick it off? What is the real reason this product did not perform at all? Was it because the concept was not understood? Or was it because the formulation? Or what was it? So when two things are coming, two things goes out, and this is always there. So we always ensure end of the year, we are still stuck with that same 120 and nothing more than that.
So you're maintaining a healthy balance. I think that is what all skincare brands do. It's just that we just see what's launched new in the market.
Correct.
Great. So, you know, we're coming to the closure. You are definitely the forefront of the skincare brands that are in the Indian market. And I think there is good quality. The only problem is consistency right now that the customer is seeing. And they're also seeing the fact that customer care is not as active or not as responsive as they would like to be. How are you going to be addressing these two issues, you know, as briefly as you can share that with me? Because I also want to get your thought on where you see skincare in another 5 years. So first, how are you going to address the top two concerns of expected quality time and again, and, you know, customer care?
See, in terms of, you know, inconsistency, the major problem, like I told you, was because of the lack of communication. It doesn't happen with every single product, but there are certain products that really goes through a reformulation or goes through any small changes. Therefore, to address that, what we are doing is we are trying to work on effective communication. We have taken the email and the Instagram route as the most effective ones because we see that a lot of consumers spend a lot of time, especially the skincare community itself, spend a lot of time on Instagram. So that's one place where we thought that we could put up a story and we could also pin that into the, you know, the, you know, what's that called, highlight section. And so consumers can go back to it at any point of time to see what are all the updates that are coming up in terms of product. And along with that, so anybody who has bought any product in the past, there is a customer database that we maintain. So if we can hit a mailer the minute even the product goes on shelf, if we can hit a mailer to the consumer, I think we've done that. I think yesterday also we sent out one mailer for this Globoost change. We're trying to work on all these parameters where we are able to connect with the consumer immediately. So even the consumer who has bought in the past, when they are reordering, they will not be in a shock. That's number one. And the Instagram channel is only to ensure that any potential buyer who is thinking to buy that product will know that my product is going to look like this. So that's the first step.
For active communication, yes. For every change.
And yes, that's the major thing. And for customer service, what we are doing is we are constantly looking out for people to join our team. There are certain issues in that. I'll tell you, we've tried to recruit a couple of people, to be very honest, for customer service. But since we are a skincare brand, we need somebody with technical knowledge to handle customer service as well. When I say technical knowledge, now these are not customer service agents who will simply type, where is my order? It's on the way to you. No. Mm-hmm. Somebody who can actually understand the nitty-gritties of the ingredients, of the formulation, who will be able to give a suggestion to the customer, what could be right, what could be wrong to the consumer. And to take that decision, that particular candidate should have certain amount of knowledge in that subject matter. So that took us a little bit of a time. So we just have one. We're planning to recruit two more people. Hopefully, if we are able to manage all of this under control, we plan to open a phone facility where somebody can call in. But to get there, we need to have this under control, the emails and the, you know, DMs and everything under control. And once this comes under control, we'll open up the phone facility.
How much time are you asking of your consumers to start expecting much better customer service?
Okay, that's a very tough one now. No,
I think I would say that much time to recruit, train and put them into.
Yes. I think 90 days. You know, end of this year, we should be in place with all of this plan. It takes 2-3 months for us to get somebody on board, to train them and to be hands-on on understanding how to handle each customer. I would say 3-4 months is an ideal time, but by 6 months, we should be entirely ready with all the process and system in place.
Great. That's so good to hear. And so Harini, where do you see the skincare market going in the next, you know, let's say 2 years, 3 years, 5 years is too long nowadays. You know, in 2 years, what do you see the skincare market evolving to? And what is your take on the actives? Are you looking at introducing those as well as pure actives like alpha butins and, you know, niacinamides and tranexamic acids?
Yeah. So, see, skincare industry in India has evolved a great deal from where we were. Yeah, we've really evolved. Yeah. And Indian consumers are very, very well informed. In fact, I would say that they're much more well informed because currently we are selling in US, we're selling in few other countries. And the amount of queries and the knowledge that we see that Indian consumers have is by far more. I think that's a good thing also, that consumers are much more well, you know, they know a lot of things in India. They know how formulation works. In fact, you know, we find it really happy to see some consumers writing to us saying that this penetrator, does it penetrate really well with this ingredient? We, you know, that's when we realize that, you know, even for customer service, we need technical people to answer, because that's not something,
you know, which I think is a both good and a bad thing, because sometimes just part of it is not knowing the real story. you know, make exactly. some self-gurus, and then you're like, how do you start convincing them that, you know, this is
it's very good to be, you know, and always inquisitive and, you know, trying right. to dig deep into whatever you are trying. Mm-hmm. But, you know, as a brand, we also have a responsibility that we shouldn't be misguiding them. So that's right. where, you know, we really have to play a very, very balanced role by yeah. not giving them any wrong information, but at the same time, ensuring that we are taking them in the right track. So the industry is moving to a phase. So there was faces in India, if you see, initially until about, you know, 2016, 17, it was all natural.
Then
it moved to Korean beauty in 2019, 2020. And then the whole of 2020 and 2021, I think, you know, it's a huge surge of, you know, all the European skincare, all the acids have come into place. It's a cycle, basically. Anything in life is a cycle. So it doesn't stay the same way, right? It has to move on. So next, you know, I keep studying a lot of markets, you know, global markets that are actually evolving much faster than us. And the upcoming trend is going to be more into minimalism. Minimalistic skincare is going to be the next in thing that's coming into the market. So while right now the face is layering, it will ultimately go to the next stage, which will be, you know, minimalizing the number of ingredients that you use on your skincare, keeping your routine completely simple. You know, that's how it's going to move into. And I'm very sure we're already starting at it right now, and we will get there. And as a brand, where I fit myself, where we fit ourselves, is we've always believed that, you know, science and, you know, the you know, clean and science actually makes a lot of sense together. When we say clean, we don't really mean to say demonize any ingredient or anything. We've always, from the beginning, believed preservatives is a must. Everything, absolutely. All of these, you know, everything, all of these are like 100%. It's a part of your, you know, skincare formulation. However, there are certain ingredients which we potentially could, you know, replace with certain ingredients. For example, let's take minoxidil. Now, when there is an ingredient like Redensil, which has proven ability to replace minoxidil, now this is called biotechnology, right? Mm. Now, still there is science involved in it, but it's a bioactive. So we try to play a balance between both the lab-based ingredients and the bioactives. And we only work on the data that we get out of these. Now, if we don't find a potential replacement for alpha arbutin, I wouldn't be, you know, we wouldn't really be comfortable selling something, you know, saying that it's a product that's going to be very effective for any kind of hyperpigmentation. So that's how we look at it, you know, keeping a balance between these. And of course, when we say sustainability, it not just, you know, pertains to the packaging per se, but the ingredients as well. So Absolutely. Let's take a shampoo bar. The lather that comes out of the shampoo bar, the gray water, should be able to be, you know, broken down into the soil. It should be biodegradable. So right. that's the effort that we take to ensure that we are not using SLS. Not that SLS is bad, but an SCI, which is sodium cocal isothionate, is much more gentler and much more biodegradable, which is safe for earth as well. While we care for ourselves, why not we do a little bit for the environment as well? So that's the ethos of the brand, and that's where we are going. So, and I think, you know, there is one thing in India right now, which I am seeing, is there is a lot of, you know, trust issues, not just with Earth Rhythm, but generally as a community. And it's completely acceptable. It's completely agreed. And it is natural. Even if I'm as a consumer sitting on the other side, I would not really trust every single brand that comes in front of me, right? So so I think, you know, where we need to really understand is sometimes when brands like us comes out and we are given an opportunity to speak, it becomes easy for the consumers to understand the brand's perspective. So that's exactly why I agreed to come today on this call, because I really want this to be, you know, heard and, you know, consumers to understand what it really means. Even yesterday on one of the posts, I saw that brands going global means international standards. No, not at all. We sell in US, we sell in UK. Believe me, the only document they ask is MSDS, which is Material Safety Data Sheet. That's it. And if you should have a valid manufacturing license to ship anywhere abroad. Only for sunscreen, they ask you for a COLIPA report. Other than that, they don't ask anything else. So that is not the standard to measure whether a brand is actually doing its best or not. Rather, the measuring capacity should be if a consumer is able to get access to any kind of material or research material which they are asking from the organization, if they are able to provide or not. That should be the way to measure it. So somebody writes to us saying that I will not order your sunscreen till you share your sunscreen report. We send this report to them. Just please see the report. So, you know, I don't blame them, because, you know, that's how your industry has been built right now, right? So people are really scared at this point of time. And we're trying our level best to ensure that we are able to address all of these. And we keep telling them as much as possible, you know, ask us for any report that you want. You want Globost report, ask us. You want, now we put some numbers on certain products on our website, even for gram-negative retinoid, we put some numbers saying that on, you know, 60% of the people, you know, had efficacy on these many number of, you know, days. Now that data comes from the clinical trial that we did for that particular formulation. Not the supplier data that we received, but the independent research that we have done in that formulation that we have owned. So that becomes very critical for consumers to know that they have spent some time and energy to check whether this particular formulation is going to be effective on someone or not.
So I think all the pieces are there at your end, and what the consumers are asking is also a very valid question. There's only there's a meeting that is not happening. So if you just have a right communication from your brand outward, I think that itself will be a big step. And, you know, the reason I wanted to get you and have a conversation with you was really because I wanted people to see the face, the actual struggles of building a brand and getting a product out there, and, you know, their real life struggles. And what we can ask is for everybody to be, you know, get along with the journey and keep pushing the brand to do better. And hopefully all of us will come out winners at the end of it. And, you know, and that's the best part for everyone. Everyone wins that way, right? We don't want anyone to lose in this battle, because the intentions of both sides are good.
Absolutely. Agreed.
Thank you so much for your time, Harini. I wish you all the best. And we'll stay in touch. It's great that you agreed to be open and out, that it takes courage. A lot of people wouldn't have agreed for it. So I give you kudos for that. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me, Rubina. It was absolutely lovely.
I love
I love the fact that you reached out on LinkedIn and, you know, we connected. Hopefully we connect again soon.
Yes. Absolutely. All the best. And I'm cheering you from the sides.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.